Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, good afternoon to everybody. It is indeed a pleasure to welcome you to IPI for this gathering on, I quote, champions for a new approach to peace building. It is a privilege for IPI to co-host this important discussion with the government of Sweden and the Dag Hammarskjöld Foundation. During this year of reflection on the UN's peace and security efforts, the review of the peacebuilding architecture has issued a bold call. In their report, the advisory group of experts on peacebuilding called for a new understanding of peacebuilding, which they term sustainable peace. In the face of today's protracted and repeated conflicts, sustaining peace means putting peacebuilding at the center of the UN's work before, during, and after conflict. It means overcoming the UN silos, both at headquarters and at UN operations on the ground, where peacebuilding takes place. It means taking a comprehensive and political approach to recovery and accepting that peace actually takes time. Indeed, sustaining peace requires a lasting commitment from resources to leadership and implementation on renewed focus on prevention. Today, we are very pleased to welcome an esteemed group of speakers to share their insights on this new approach to peace building. And we look very much forward to hearing from our panel, which is featuring Margot Wallström, Foreign Minister of Sweden, Samora Kamara, Foreign Minister of Sierra Leone, Mangala Samaravera, Foreign Minister of Sri Lanka, and Mauro Vieira, Foreign Minister of Brazil, and George Chicote, Foreign Minister of Angola. We're also very pleased to have with us Mogens Lykketoft, who is the president of the 70th session of the UN General Assembly. And last but not at least, my old friend, Oscar Fernandez, who is the US, the UN Assistant Secretary General for peacebuilding support. The biographies of this distinguished panel is in your program, so I will not bother and take time to give a more detailed presentation of these illustrious personalities who I'm seated with. Following their remarks, we will also benefit from the insights of Gert Rosenthal, head of the Advisory Council, the advisory group of experts on review of peacebuilding architecture. We're also very pleased to be joined today by the Foreign Minister of Somalia, Foreign Minister of Guatemala, Finland, Bangladesh, and Liberia. We know that today's conversation will bring new perspectives and point us towards operational tools to sustain peace. We also hope to reflect on synergies with a high-level review on peace operations and the review of women, peace and security, which is also, as you all know, taking place this year. To that end, IPI has just launched an online knowledge platform to highlight analysis from experts, practitioners, and local actors on UN peace operations, which will tie together themes from all three reviews. And without further introduction, we are happy to hear first from Margot Wallström. Sweden, of course, has a long engagement with UN peacebuilding work and serves this year as the chair of the UN Peacebuilding Commission. And given this leadership, Margot, we are looking forward to your views. So Margot, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming from, I guess, short and hectic meetings to something that is inherently long-term in nature, peace building. Thank you very much to the IPI for hosting us. Some people might have come for the view only, but you are also welcome. The best place to be, of course, is in this building. Thank you to Dag Hammarskjöld Foundation. And something interesting always happens here every day. Mr. President, Mogens Lykketoft, yesterday in your speech, you noted that never before has such a large share of humanity enjoyed so good a life, yet never before have we been at greater risk of fundamentally disrupting the basic living conditions on our small globe. So you stressed the linkages between development, peace and security, and respect for human rights, and to make progress in each of these areas. And yesterday also, unprecedented pledges were made by member states to UN peacekeeping. Welcome to that. And to quote Ambassador Power's closing words, these commitments have the power to transform the enterprise of peacekeeping. Now, for peace to endure, peacekeeping needs to be complemented by equally effective peace building. And this meeting is aimed at exactly that, to strengthen the United Nations peace building capacities. I would like to put forward a call for a more proactive United Nations with reinforced capacity to respond to conflicts. And I want to see a United Nations that puts sustaining peace back at the core of its business, through ramping up conflict prevention capacity, adopting a more holistic approach to peace building, and also ensuring that all engagement is built on thorough political understanding. And I think everything that happens to us today just gives proof that to the fact that this is necessary. And to create such a shift, we need a political courage and determination and leadership, of course. And Sweden is deeply committed to do its part. I can only speak for my country. Let me mention three specific areas where we need more action. Firstly, effective implementation of Resolution 1325. You might have expected me to say that. This is crucial to achieving sustainable results, because we know that early investments in inclusive peace-building processes that empower women lay a stronger foundation for reconciliation, which in turn contributes to reducing the risk of relapse. We know it's the best investment you can do. We know it, we have proof of that. And together we need to ensure that the Women, Peace and Security agenda is placed at the center of our discussions and mainstreamed into aspects and phases of UN engagement, analysis, planning, training and implementation. Where are the women in the ongoing peace processes and negotiations? Are there women around the table? Are they involved? Secondly, we must acknowledge that, of course, the United Nations is not the only actor in the field. And for Sweden, finding ways to improve cooperation between the UN and regional, sub-regional organizations such as the African Union is a priority. And this means institutionalizing a cooperation to define burden sharing and ensure also predictable financing of regional organizations' capacity to respond to conflicts. And I think that such strategic partnerships are crucial to ensure also early warnings and early action. So we need smart and inclusive partnerships with civil society, and some of you are also here today, or many of you are here today. And by drawing on these actors' knowledge and experiences, we will get a deeper understanding of local realities, and that's a prerequisite for effective UN engagement. Finally, my third point, if we are serious about adopting a new approach to peace building, we also have to make sure that our allocations of resources are aligned with the rhetoric. We are currently spending billions of dollars on humanitarian aid and peacekeeping, and we have to invest more in conflict prevention. And the review of the peace-building architecture, as well as a report of the high-level independent panel on peace operations, put forward innovative suggestions on financing, and we have to discuss that over the coming months. And we have to do better in demonstrating the results of our efforts by conveying also some of the success stories where peace was maintained and an escalation of violence was averted. So the Peace Building Fund, I think, has demonstrated its unique added value for early, rapid, and flexible support to peace building. And as a significant donor to the fund, we urge others to step in to ensure that any shortfall can be averted. So, as the current chair of the Peacebuilding Commission, and we have our ambassador here as well, Sweden will do its utmost to make sure that the Commission capitalizes on this momentum. And we also need to relate to other initiatives. The international dialogue on peacebuilding and state building is one important platform for promoting sustainable peace in fragile societies. I think I will stop there to allow also my colleagues to intervene, and I know that my colleague from Sri Lanka also would like to come in early. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, Margot, for a concise, clarifying, comprehensive, and I think candid intervention, very action-oriented, very practical, and admirably brief. And I wish all of you will emulate Margot concerning both briefness and clarity. Unfortunately, Mangala, I know you have to go to an urgent meeting, so I will give you the floor first, and I fully respect that you will have to leave thereafter. So Mangala, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ambassador Rod Larson, President of the International Peace Institute. Fellow members of the head table, foreign ministers, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed a great honor to join you today to discuss the important issue of peace building. I thank the government of Sweden and the International Peace Institute for convening this meeting today, and the subject that we are discussing, peace and peace building, are essential elements in the post-2015 development agenda, especially for us in Sri Lanka, where we are working out at the moment the architecture of a durable peace. In fact, the people of Sri Lanka began a remarkable journey of political reform on the 8th of January this year by electing a new president with a clear mandate to usher in reconciliation and good governance, strengthening the rule of law, and to rebuild democratic institutions. And also in the parliamentary elections that concluded last month on the 17th of August, the people of my country further cemented this mandate in one of the most peaceful elections in nearly three decades. The high voter turnout at both elections demonstrated that the people of Sri Lanka wanted its political leaders to stop the contentious political fragmentation and move towards a lasting peace, healing the broken hearts and minds of our people, building a nation which takes pride in its diversity, and ensuring reconciliation and development while guaranteeing non-recurrence is now our top priority. In our peace-building efforts, ladies and gentlemen, our government has had to also deal with re-establishing and renewing Sri Lanka's partnerships with the international community, the United Nations, the think tanks, and the NGOs, as well as some of our bilateral partners. Therefore, it is not only an inward-looking journey where we try to formulate responses or find answers by ourselves. We need the support of all of Sri Lanka's friends out there to walk this journey with us until we are able to walk alone. In fact, we are committed to the reconciliation process by embracing each and every citizen in our multi-ethnic, multicultural, and multi-religious nation as part of the whole. Today, for the first time in 32 years, Sri Lanka's opposition leader is from a political party representing the Tamil minority, which is also the party in parliament which received the third highest turnout at the last election. Peace building at its core is a process that must strive to prevent future conflict and also address the root causes of conflict. Conflict is not a period-specific event, it is a phenomenon that builds over time. Our vision is to usher in a nation that is at peace with itself and with the world, a nation that engages with the international community and international organizations, share information, and seeks solutions through collaboration discussion and dialogue. As an active member of the United Nations for 6 years, we are committed to the role of the UN, not only as peacekeepers, but also as peace builders at every stage and cycle of conflict. We must engage in prevention, management, and transformation. We are grateful to the United Nations Peacebuilding Fund for recognizing our efforts this year in continuing to move forward as an engaged and vibrant member of the international community, committed to democratic principles and respect for human rights as our bedrock. We deeply appreciate the Peacebuilding Fund and the Peacebuilding Support Office as they work towards supporting peacebuilding initiatives in a post-conflict situation such as ours, and we look forward to engaging with them further as Sri Lanka endeavors to return to her own. As part of our peacebuilding efforts, we are committed to conducting independent inquiries into disappearances, murders of journalists and activists and missing persons, the resettlement of the remaining internally displaced persons without delay, and the handing back of lands to people who have been dispossessed of their properties during the conflict. Non-return of these lands had been one of the major grievances of the people of the northern province. Reconciliation, as you know, will take time, but it is a vital tool in the peace-building arsenal, and it is important. Importance cannot be overstated. In Sri Lanka, it includes truth-seeking, justice, reparations, and non-recurrence. Truth-seeking not as a witch hunt, but as an effort to heal and forgive, and in the interest of justice, the rule of law and accountability. I would now like to end by reiterating Sri Lanka's commitment to positive engagement with the UN, international organizations, the world community, and all stakeholders in working to strengthen security, human rights development in our peace building efforts. I thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much, Mangala. Thank you very much for those very illuminating words about recent developments in your country. I will now move on to Samora Kamara, who is the Foreign Minister of Sierra Leone. And we are looking forward to for you to share with us the experience of your countries and your country's peace-building process. And as an economist and, I believe, former Minister for Finance, you might also share with us insights on development after conflict. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. All other protocols observed. Perhaps at the outset, to convince you why we should be called upon at all times, we are offering ourselves as a blueprint in the Peace Building Commission engagement in post-conflict countries, given the mile that we have had with the support and the cooperation and the partnership that we developed with the Peace Building Commission. And therefore, Sierra Leone is ready to share its experiences, both at the multilateral level as well as bilaterally to other member countries. Mr. Chairman, where we are today is a clear indication that you have a continual role to play. It's very difficult to get out of post-conflict reconstruction situation. One or two years ago, we were taken off the United Nations Security Council agenda as an agenda item for peace building, but then we are placed under PBC engagement on a demand basis. Now, we thought we were going forward until most recently we had three unforeseen shocks. The first shock was Ebola, and today we are struggling with trying to get Ebola to resilient zero, and from zero we're trying to have a post-Ebola recovery program that will address the rebuilding of the health sector and other related institutions, that will look at economic recovery, social protection, etc. But at the same time, we're also looking at other developmental aspects. The other shock was purely external also, and that's the international price shocks. When we thought we had a commodity that was going to lift us up, by this year, to next year, we're thinking of having even a neutral or surplus budget. until the significant drop in the price of iron ore, which was really a major commodity. Now we seem to have some problems. As we try to put Ebola and these shocks, these two shocks behind us, we now have another shock. Last week, we had a massive flood. This is the first time, right, that Sierra Leone experienced this type of floods, where, as of now, we have well over 6,000 to 7,000 homeless, and they are being housed at the football stadium. Now, these are factors that will encourage Sierra Leone to come back, clapping hands to the Peace Building Fund for support. But having said that, at the international level, we've just hailed the coming up of the SDGs. But yes, there has been an endorsement, but I think the greatest battle is walking the talk, and that is walking out the SDGs. And this is where the PBC has a major role, drawing from the experience in conflict-affected countries. But I also believe one of the major challenges of implementing the SDGs, if we are to make a very serious impact in the world today, I'm not saying that conflicts will never end, but we need to have conflict-sensitive type of approaches and programs so that we'll be able to move forward, given that a number of countries are still in conflict. Those of us who are out of conflict will still have the scare that conflicts would always recur if you do not address the root causes of conflict, do not have good preventive programs, do not have good human welfare type of programs. So I think going forward, the PBC is just an institution. And I was making the joke in the waiting room that I would love to see between now and the end of the year how many new institutions will evolve to access all resources that are indicated with respect to finding financing the SDGs. This is a time for institutional rivalry. It is a time where you need strong, as you already mentioned, smart partnership, institutional partnership. So which means we have to work together. Those of us who have worked with the PBC, we need to come out very strongly in our advocacy that this, even within the UN system, as we streamline the UN institutions to make them more relevant, more legitimate, more coordinated, this is the time we should also bring out the role of the PBC. Yesterday, we are champions of the New Deal, the G7 Plus. The issue came up, how we can move away from what we call doing business as usual. And we spent a lot of time trying to define what that means, doing business as usual. Perhaps the PBC will also come in and try to help us define that, and all of us will be able to move forward. I think if I can just stop here, because where we are now, you have two types of elements, major components in development. You have the software, the governance issues, and I think a lot of institutions that do not want proper accountability, they take the soft ground. They go into these humanitarian, they go into the governance issues. I'm going to build civil society capacity and all the rest of it. But the hardware, it is the hardware that really, this is why you see visible evidence. It is through this hardware that you really try to minimize the root causes of conflict. Because if you build good health infrastructure, good education infrastructure, good road infrastructure, I think you're more than halfway through this sort of thing. I always make the experience of my experience in South Africa in 1995, when I went for the first elections. People came out. Why? They said, yes, there was apartheid, but why you don't have apartheid was in the roads. We all walk on the same road. And this stuff. So I think we need to refocus our attention. Let's go more for developmental aspects. Many countries have made a lot of ground on the governance issues, political governance, building democracy, and engaging the civil society. So I think that type of inclusiveness, as it continues, we also need to provide strong facilities. Mr. Chairman, I will stop here. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Samura. for sharing those insights with us, and again, concise, brief, admirably. And I will now turn to you, Mauro. Brazil served as the UN Peacebuilding's Commission's chair, and I know you were stressing the importance of national and regional ownership over peace. And I do hope that you will elaborate on that topic in your intervention. You have the floor.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Margot Wallström, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Sweden, Mr. President of the General Assembly, Liketoff, and Mr. Larsen, President of IPI, and our moderator today. First and foremost, let me thank my colleague Margot Wallström for inviting me to this important meeting. It gives me the opportunity to express my appreciation for the outstanding work carried out by the Kingdom of Sweden in chairing the Peacebuilding Commission this year. The establishment of the Peacebuilding Commission was a major landmark in the UN history. Its creation was a recognition that in order to achieve sustainable peace, the international community must tackle the underlying causes of conflicts, including its socio-economic drivers. Peacebuilding deals with a matter very close to Brazil's heart, which is the understanding that development leads to peace and peace leads to development. Peacebuilding is also built on the belief that diplomacy matters deeply. No wonder why Brazil has supported the work of the Peacebuilding Commission from day one. It was our steadfast commitment in the Commission and to what it stands for that led Brazil to chair the Peacebuilding Commission in 2014 and convene its first annual session. Brazil also tries to help countries break the vicious cycles of instability and violence on the ground. In Haiti, in Timor-Leste, in Guinea-Bissau, and in other corners of the world, we have been lending our good office and sharing our social technology as a means to prevent violence from relapsing. 10 years after the creation of the Peacebuilding Commission, time is ripe to take stock of what has been accomplished so far and to identify what still requires improvement. Despite progress made, the United Nations still dedicates too many human and financial resources to dealing with crisis management and far too little to avoiding armed conflicts and to ensuring that they do not happen again. As the international community struggles to deal with the urgency of now, we leave unattended the emergencies of tomorrow. Sustainable peace requires solid long-term commitment, constant support, sustained attention, and reliable financing. As the chair of the Guinea-Bissau configuration of the Peacebuilding Commission since 2007, Brazil realized that these efforts are not likely to attract the headlines. They are, however, essential elements to write the successful stories of the post-conflict countries striving towards peace, stability, and development. The three processes of review taking place at the United Nations this year, peacekeeping, peace building, architecture and women, peace and security, present us with a remarkable opportunity to prop out our strategies towards durable and sustainable peace. In this regard, we congratulate the advisory group of experts on review of the peace and building architecture and its chairman, Mr. Gert Rosenthal, for producing a valuable reform that should constitute the basis for our future discussion on this issue. The report reminded us that it is imperative to embrace a more comprehensive approach to peace building, one that encompasses all phases of the peace process, from conflict prevention through peacekeeping to post-conflict recovery. In order to achieve this goal, we must unify the pillars of peace and security, human rights and development. This new way of looking at the three pillars of the United Nations requires that the General Assembly, the Security Council, and the Economic and Social Council strengthen their partnership in addressing the challenges to sustainable peace. It also requires overcoming the fragmentation of the Secretariat and the UN agencies, funds, and programs. As suggested in the report, Brazil believes that the Peacebuilding Commission should deepen and strengthen its advisory role to the General Assembly and the Security Council. The Commission should take up responsibility for the follow-up of the countries on the Council's agenda, where peace consolidation has progressed to the point that it is deemed that they no longer constitute a threat to international peace and security. Financing for peace building is another critical issue. While countries emerging from conflict need significant financing over extended periods, financing for peace building activities remain scarce. Peace building requires sustainable support from the international community. We must depart from the notion that development-related activities should only be financed by voluntary contributions. Brazil is convinced that this kind of investment in peace will pay itself in short time as we manage to sustain stability, avoid the recurrence of conflict, and prevent the costly deployment of peacekeeping missions. In closing, I would like to reaffirm Brazil's continued commitment to the Peacebuilding Commission. The work done by the Commission benefits people beyond the walls of this magnificent building. It helps alleviate the plight of men, women, and children all across the globe whose right to dignity the international community has no right to overlook. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mauro, for your commitment, and also for sharing with us your experiences, and also to giving us reminders of the values and the intentions which propelled the Peace Building Commission forward, and at least but not at last, also for reminding us that this costs money and it has to be provided. So, George, I will now turn to you. Your country, Angola, will serve as co-chair of the upcoming intergovernmental negotiations that will determine the outcome of the peace building review. And I hope that you now will share with us insights and priorities for this process. So the floor is yours.
Excellencies, I thank the government of Sweden and the International Peace Institute for convening this important meeting on crucial issue of peace building in post-conflict situations. My country, Angola, as you know, went through a long period of civil strife. Since 2002, we are building peace and the premises for sustainable peace. Two electoral processes took place. A new constitution was adopted. The government and national stakeholders have been addressing the root causes of our conflict in order to prevent a relapse into conflict. Angola is eager to share its rich experience with the international community. As chair of the ad hoc working group on conflict prevention and resolution in Africa, a subsidiary group organ of the Security Council, Angola is implementing a program of work focused on the cooperation between the United Nations and the African Union and discussions on a certain number of issues which may contribute to conflict prevention in Africa, namely peace building, elections, preventive diplomacy, culture of peace, and the illegal exploitation of natural resources. Angola was honored with its appointment as co-facilitator of the intergovernmental process of the review of the UN peacebuilding architecture. And I take the occasion to commend the advisory group of experts for their report, a good starting point to reform the mechanisms and ACTA procedures of the United Nations peacebuilding architecture. Angola and Australia, as co-facilitators, are committed to engage with the UN member states to assess the contents of the report, its recommendations and conclusions. This process outcome will be a draft resolution reflecting the general consensus on the new architecture for the UN peace building, with a view of making possible to reach sustained peace and stability for post-conflict countries. The report of the advisory working group identifies a number of challenges, such as the fragmentation of the UN system in dealing with the issue and budgetary constraints. It proposes a closely working relationship between the UN Security Council with other UN bodies, such as the Economic Social Council and the Peacebuilding Commission, in order to comprehensively address post-conflict situations, whether political, economic, social, or human. It stresses the peacebuilding is sustained by three pillars of the United Nations: peace and security, development, and human rights. The review can give an opportunity to the Peacebuilding Commission strengthen its functions, advisory, bringing and convening, while promoting more coherence of the UN system. The financial constraints are also to be addressed through mechanisms that ensure predictability, resource mobilization, and better cooperation between the United Nations and international financial institutions such as the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank. Angola and Australia have already discussed and agreed on the calendar for intergovernmental process, namely the discussion and negotiation of the draft resolution timeline to be presented and adopted by the UN Security Council and General Assembly. Angola and Australia look forward to continue working with the entire UN membership and all interested parties, like the International Peace Institute, to promote the discussion around this review process of peace building and sustainable peace. I thank you.
Thank you very much for that intervention. I think what you are calling upon us all to be is to be silo busters, to break down the silos and have a more holistic and integrated approach, breaking down the fragmentation of the system, and also look at the intimately interlinked elements of peace and security, development, and human rights. And at that backdrop, I will move to you, Morgans. You are the president of the General Assembly, and you play a major role in moving forward the new approach to peace building. And we are all very interested in hearing your thoughts and your plans for the year ahead. Morgans, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. And also my thanks to Sweden and the IPI and the Commercial Foundation for taking the lead in bringing us together. It's very important with three foreign ministers with concrete national experience of the problems of peace building and two more to share with us their experience in this discussion. Just yesterday we had this peace operation summit. A host of countries made commitments to strengthen the UN's capacity to fulfill its role in this important area, but while peacekeeping can indeed bring about an end to violent confrontation, peace building is about sustaining peace, as more already have said. The long-term approach required to build and maintain peace was vividly illustrated by an example only a couple of weeks ago, when Mozambique, after some 22 years after the end of the Civil War, was finally declared free of landmines. An achievement to be celebrated, of course, but also an illustration of what we are talking about here. Statements so far from some of the champions of the new approach to peace building have demonstrated that national experiences offer valuable lessons about the complexities and uncertainties of building sustainable peace and about the ever-present risk, of course, of relapses. We heard how national ownership remains a key factor, how solutions must be anchored in the local context, and it is clear also that to secure resilient and more sustainable outcomes, solution must be rooted in inclusive political processes that are based on the rule of law and respect for universal human rights. The United Nations is one of the few external actors often present both before, during, and after conflict and instability, remains, of course, a central actor in global efforts to support peace building. But as we also heard, and as was pointed out very clearly in the report of the advisory group of experts, the continued fragmentation of the UN system from a policy and operations perspective, but also from a financial one, has become a significant draw on the ability of the UN to engage efficiently and effectively in this area. This year, however, we have an excellent opportunity to address some of this fragmentation and further advance the UN's overall approach to sustaining peace. The three central review processes underway, one of UN peacekeeping operations, one on peacebuilding architecture, and one on women, peace, and security, are at various stages of advancement today, but it is critical that these three reviews move forward in a complementary manner, consistent with each other. On the 11th and 12th of May next year, therefore, I will, as President of the General Assembly, organize a high-level thematic debate to identify synergies and strengthen coherence between these three reports. This debate can serve as one of the platforms for member states, regional organizations, academia, civil society, to translate the linkages into comprehensive policy and operational answers to some of the challenges we face today. Ladies and gentlemen, the last few days at the UN and the adoption of the 2030 agenda in particular has filled me with great hope and anticipation for the year ahead. And as President of the General Assembly, I am personally committed to advancing the efficient and effective engagement by this organization in peace and security matters, and I will do my utmost to live up to expectations and hopes that that I have heard expressed here today, and I think we very much agree on what's needed to do also in the financial area, where I would love, but not promise, that we already in the upcoming budget negotiations would have a more coherent financing of the reconciliation efforts and the peacekeeping operations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Morgans, for, I think I would say first, your enthusiasm and your dedication and your commitment to the Peace Building Commission, but also for giving us a kind of a bird's view of that incredibly complex landscape which has to be navigated, and also to give us some guidance on how you see that we should navigate that landscape. And last and not least, that you once again remind us that it demands financing. Mm-hmm. And that was a message to all of you.
Yeah.
Oscar, the master of everything, you have the floor.
Thank you, Tyre. And again, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, foreign ministers, excellencies. Again, let me add my voice of strong appreciation to the government of Sweden, here represented by our very good friend, Margot Wallström, as well as Tyre IPI for organizing this event, and our good friends in the Dag Hammarskjöld Foundation, too, with whom we work very closely. I will be reading here the Secretary General's message to this event. Unfortunately, he is currently in a luncheon meeting of the Security Council, which explains why he's not here. So in his place, I start by the following. I send my greetings to the International Peace Institute and all gathered for this timely event. I thank Ambassador Skog of Sweden for his exemplary leadership as chair of the Peacebuilding Commission. We are living through a period of multiple crises that are stretching our responses to the limits. As we respond to immediate crises, we need to do more to address the root causes of conflict and build the long-term foundations of peace. Predictable, sustained support to breaking out of the vicious cycle of crisis and response is essential. But too often, we fall short as attention passes to the next emergency. If we do not act urgently to prevent lapse and relapse into violence, we will condemn the peoples of this world to continued suffering and ourselves to the spiraling and unsustainable costs of crisis response. The advisory group of experts I appointed to support the 2015 Peacebuilding Review have reminded us that sustaining peace must be understood as a core task of the UN Charter. It must be the thread that runs through all our actions across the life cycle of conflicts. Sustaining peace requires coherent and coordinated action among the UN's principal organs, between headquarters and the field, and among different peacebuilding actors. The Peacebuilding Commission, as an advisory body, can play a crucial role in bringing the attention of key actors to these challenges. Sustainable, durable peace can only ever be built on genuine, broadly inclusive national ownership. Only last April, at the Security Council open debate, we discussed how involving youth in peacebuilding processes is essential to stemming the growth of radicalization. And women, too, must be empowered to play their central role as agents of peace. Sustaining peace is impossible without long-term political and financial support or without partnerships among local communities, governments, the private sector, and regional and international organizations. I am delighted that the Peacebuilding Fund has amassed a proven record of catalytic support to kickstart critical peacebuilding interventions. To deliver its full potential, though, the Peacebuilding Fund urgently needs greater support and refinancing. The Sustainable Peace Report proposes a paradigm that is both new and old. In many ways, it seeks to revive the vision of my predecessors, Dag Hammarskjöld, who stated in 1954 that, quote, "The pursuit of peace and progress, with its trials and its errors, its successes and its setbacks, can never be relaxed and never abandoned," end of quote. At this time of turmoil and test, I call on all of us to rally behind this vision. I thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much, Oscar, for that message from the Secretary General. And I think, again, we are hearing at the essence of it, we need everybody relevant to open their wallets and support our efforts, or unless it will not be possible to do what everybody around this table actually is calling for. It is now my pleasure to turn to our architect, namely Gert, who is an expert on the inner machinations of the UN, and also how to transform that machinery into being an engine of change. Gert, I hope that you will share with us some of the insights from the Peacebuilding Review and its findings. So Gert, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Tejan. Thank you for inviting me to this gathering. I'm going to be extremely brief because I see that there's very little time. Three important points. The first, to echo what you said, and also in the Secretary General's message, that we should not think of peace building as something that happens in countries or only in countries that emerge from conflict. Mm-hmm. Because when we do that, obviously, you have to extinguish the fire first, and then you deal with the rest. We stress in our report that peace building occurs in all phases of the crisis, before, during, and after. And we very much believe that a sustainable peace is a much better term to use. We also believe that peace building is something that essentially happens on the ground in the hands of domestic actors. It's something that essentially has to do with finding common ground about the different actors. So we feel that the role of the UN is to enable rather than to go out there and do things. The third thing, and maybe the most important, is that to sustain peace, it's absolutely true that you need development. It's you know, commonly said, but nevertheless true, that you can't have peace without development, you can't have development without peace. When you translate that into what the UN does, you find this fragmentation that several of you have alluded to. Security Council deals with peace, international peace and security, ECOSOC and General Assembly deal with development. We have to find ways for them to work together. And it isn't all that hard, but the main thing, I would say, if you ask me one suggestion, we need to change the mindset of the House. Because if you ask us as experts, where is the problem is the government's. But the solution is also the government's. We need a change of mindset, because the fragmentation that emerges from the differentiation the Charter makes between what the Security Council does, the General Assembly does, and the ECOSOC do, has fragmented the House, and this filters down into the Secretariat, the way the Secretariat is organized, and it filters down to the field. So what we need is to have a conversation among ourselves, to agree to work together. Everybody in his own domain. The General Assembly should not incur into the domain of the Security Council, nor vice versa. But it shouldn't be that difficult for us all to work together and to truly look for sustainable peace, which would be in accordance with the Sustainable Development Goal 16. That's what I can tell you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Again, as we can see, a silo buster who knows, as I said before, the inner machinations of the UN probably better than any, and you all heard his appeal, and we should take it very seriously. May I now turn at last to IPI Senior Advisor Youssef Mahmoud and ask him to give some reflections on linking this review and his work together with colleagues at the UN on issues related to peace operations. Again, silo busting. You have the floor, Youssef.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Terry. Speaking last, there is very little I can add except to summarize, because I've also a member of the High-Level Advisory Group on 1325. I've tried to pick up what are some of the threads that could help our common search in looking for synergies and coherence. And I'm very happy to hear the President of the General Assembly intends to do just that in May next year. In addition to looking for efforts that marry the three pillars of the United Nations and secure the appropriate financing for peacebuilding, let me just mention three additional guidance that we should look for as we look for increased coherence and synergy between these three global policy reviews, namely the Peace Operation Review, the Peace Building, and the 1325. Number one, it has been also said, are they people-centered? Are the new innovative approaches are people-centered? In other words, those who are the receiving end, are they in the lead? Delivering peace and sustaining it and making it less reversible depends on the quality of engagement and the quality of listening to these local actors. Second, recognizing women's leadership. It has been said, it's not said enough, but it's not being implemented. And this is a common thread, certainly in the two reports and the two panels that I've been a member of. And the full implementation of the Women, Peace, and Security will enlarge the lens by which women can view their role in peace building, and more importantly, it will help women identify the policy making spaces in which they can participate. Last, a renewed commitment to prevention. A prevention that is based on effective and inclusive context analysis. Mm-hmm. These are some of the main guiding principle that hopefully will help member states look for coherence and synergy among the recommendations of these various global policy reviews. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Josef. May I then turn for concluding remarks to the panel? Unfortunately, time is running out. I hoped I could open for questions, but I have to respect that many of you are going straight to meetings, and I don't want that to a domino effect to be driven from IPI so that you are late for every single meeting for the rest of the day. Under normal circumstances, I would have been more liberal, but this is the General Assembly, and we have to be respectful of the meetings that many, many of you in this audience has. So I will then start from my right-hand side, very brief. By the way, I have to compliment the panel. They've been emulating Margot, being to the point, very brief, very practical, but also excellent in conceptualizing the issues at hand. So quick remarks from different participants. Mr. And when Chair, I said quick, I mean quick.
Issues have just been clearly stated. We all know what the issues are, how to move forward. But I can just reiterate our offer that Sierra Leone stands by to provide any post-conflict experience in terms of normal economic and social programs, human development, but more so on what we think the UN institutions can do better and in a different way to move forward, learning from our experience.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. I'd like, first of all, to thank Margot for inviting us. Thank you for IPC for hosting this meeting. I just would like to stress the importance of this issue for Brazil. Brazil is very much committed to with peacekeeping and, of course, with peace building commissions. We have taken very active part in different initiatives of the UN around the world, and we want to continue to do so. So thank you very much for inviting us.
Thank you again, Margot.
From words to deeds, I guess, is what we could conclude with, and maybe to make sure that we then live up to everything wise that has been said here, and we will soon see more women around the negotiating tables and in the peace processes. That's what I'm looking forward to. And thank you to all of you for coming and to all of your contributions.
Thank you, Margot, and then I will move to you, George. Yeah.
I think I also have to thank you for inviting us, and I will just say that Angola and Australia are committed to work on the negotiation for the resolution that will be presented to the General Assembly and the Security Council. Thank you.
I want to say I got reassured that these processes are in good hands. And we will certainly, from my office, try to draw upon all of you in order to make our contribution to this process of making things done on the peace building area. Thank you.
Well, as Ambassador Rosenthal said, the solutions lie in how member states in the upcoming consultations decide to go from words into action. So that would be my first point, is that it's extremely important that everybody remains engaged and that this ownership is a member state ownership, because here we are playing, if you will, or defining the future of the UN's value added in this front. The second is, we do have an instrument to promote one of the important goals of the SDG 17, for the UN to be a better partner, for us to be responsive, flexible, coherent, and reply and respond in real time to support the building of national capacities and addressing a lot of the root causes of conflict. We have the instrument. It's called the Peacebuilding Fund. It's undercapitalized. We need urgent support. Thank you.
So the only thing which remains for me now is to thank you all. It's exactly 30 minutes past the hour. And I think I will limit myself to thank you, the panelists, for your insights, for your wisdom, but most of all for the dedication and the enthusiasm which we've heard from you all in addressing the issues at hand. And I do hope that all of you will join me in a big hand for this illustrious panel. Thank you very much to all of you.